right? So let's talk about what we are going to talk about in this 1 hour session, right? So if you all know about Edereka, so we are the ones who actually say take care of the Android application development program, right? So what you can do is you can go on to the link which we have mentioned here, which says http://edereka.co, and you can check out what we have to offer in the Android development course to all of you, right? And you have contact details, so if you want to get in touch with us, you can always call on these numbers and get in touch with us. Right, so we were talking about how exactly this complete course works. So we talk about, we have live online classes. So if you talk about the entire curriculum that we have divided the entire course into 10 sections of it, which we call as 10 classes. So we'll be having live online classes for those 10 sections or 10 revisions that we have made to this Android development program. Every single recording will be available for all of you into your LMS, right? So once you create or once you have, say, taken this course, what happens is you get an LMS access. And what happens is every single section or every single class that is being provided to you is also recorded in parallel. And what happens is it gets uploaded into your LMS accounts. So that if you feel like referring to them, you can just go on, log into your LMS accounts and refer to those presentations or refer to those online classes. Neil, I hope you can see my screen now. Got it. And then if you talk about how, for example, you are actually working on some assignments that have been given to you and you're facing a few challenges while working on those assignments, right? So there's a 24/7 post-class support. When we talk about post-class support, we also talk about it as a ticket-based support. That is, you get stuck up somewhere, you just raise a ticket about the problem that you're stuck up with, and we'll be helping you out on the problems or on the areas that you find our support on, right? So that is what the 24 support means here. Also, every single module will be having a few questions and a few assignments along with it. So it's like whenever you take a session, there will be a few assignments that are given to you and a few quizzes that might be asked from you, right? So everyone has to make sure that you work on those assignments in order to complete this course. Post some time, that is once we have got or say gained much understanding about Android concepts, what we're doing is we'll also in parallel start working on the object, right? So the motive or say how we actually take this course is that we first of all make you capable. Once you have been made capable of working on an Android project, we assign you a project, and what you need to do is you need to complete the project within the specified time frame. When I say complete the project, it means that it has been successfully reviewed by all of us, and then once its review process is over, then only we'll be distributing the certificates to all of you, right? So the last part is the certificate distribution. Any person having any questions, any doubts in understanding how this entire process works, which is a 10-week long process or say 10 sessions long process for all of you, and wherein you'll be able to create a project on Android applications all by yourself. Questions, queries from anyone? I'll wait for everyone to respond back if you have any questions. If everything is fine, you can just try to go ahead so that we can move ahead with the session today. I'll wait for your responses back onto the chat window. Moving on, let's talk about the objectives, all right? Objectives of the session that we have here, right? So at the end of this module, we'll be able to, all right, Neil has a question here. Can we develop for the latest Android M release? That's correct, Neil, we can develop for the latest Android M release, but let me tell you what happens is, it works like this. Over a period of time, what happens is a few APIs get added up to the Android repository, or say ISA, the Android SDK, right? So whenever we are building an application, we also make sure that we are creating the applications for backward compatibility as well, right? So there are a few components. If you talk about, there's a few components which call as the minimum SDK version, then we have the compiled with SDK version, and then we also have a few target SDK versions, right? So once we'll be talking about those concepts, then you'll understand that we should not immediately develop for the latest version, right? We should be actually catering to n number of versions so that our device range is high. So that's how we actually work with it, right? We can always make use of the latest APIs, but what's the point of using those latest APIs if they are not available on every single device? I hope you got my point. Alright. Well, Krishna has a question here. Android 5.0 Lollipop has so many disadvantages. So how do we develop new application? What is that? Mr. Krishna, I'm not much aware about the disadvantages. I would say there could be problems with a few releases, but not I do not see any disadvantages as such here. Alright, so let's talk about what is the objective for this session. We'll be talking about the various building blocks of any Android application. We'll talk about how exactly the lifecycle of an activity works, and we'll talk about app monetization and how Android has evolved over a period of time. Right, Neil and Vomi Krishna, I hope I have answered you both. So let's talk about what we have here is an HOP, that is an email messenger application, right? HOP application that we have shown here as a sample for all of you, wherein it has utilized few of the Android Lollipop SDK APIs. So if you see here, what is happening is there is a few layers, right? There are a few layers that are specifically available in Android Lollipop SDK that have been used while creating this HOP application or the HOP email messenger, which requires, for example, a valid API, a few set of animations that have added up to Android 5.0. Similarly, a few web services specifically handles a few design guidelines and a few color schemes that have been added up to this HOP application. Now let's also talk about how exactly Android is holding an edge in the market, right? So if you talk about what happens is that whenever you create something, right, there has to be a user base for it. So when we talk about a user base, there is no better user base at this point in time when we talk about mobility, right? There's nothing bigger than mobility at this point in time. So if you talk about what happens is that every day around 1 million new Android devices are activated worldwide. When I say activated worldwide, you can understand how big is this market, right? How big is the user base? How big is the scope that you can sell your idea to, right? So when I say how big is the scope, I say I have an idea, right? And I believe that idea can work for any number of people. So if you can think of this as a large market to explore. So if I talk about the large market that we have in terms of the Android application development, you can also see that it is also working on an ecosystem, right? When I talk about an ecosystem, what I necessarily mean, just give me a moment, guys. Just switch it up now. When I talk about an ecosystem, so the Android ecosystem consists of Google as the main, I would say, the main contributor to the Android ecosystem, where they keep publishing the new SDK versions, they keep aligning the new or rolling out the new SDK OS that is available on the device. Then we have OEMs, all right? OEMs are actually a term that you can think of OEMs as something that are manufactured the devices but they are manufacturing it with the help of something else. So if I talk about OEMs like Samsung, HTC, what they are doing is they are actually having their own hardware. However, the software that is something that they do not own, right? They ship it up with the help of the Android operating system. Then there are a few development houses. Alright, so the development houses are the ones that contribute to this ecosystem in a large manner. N number of applications be published by the various development houses, and that is where we leverage the house, or say leverage the ecosystem of Android. It is the App Store, right? It is the Google Play Store that is holding these N number of applications that are created by these dev houses, and that is what is a money making opportunity for the freelancers. Any person having any questions understanding how this entire ecosystem is working in order to create applications? Any questions, any doubts? I'll wait for everyone to respond back. Again, the same process. What does the freelancers do? What happens is Android is an open source, right? So but what happens with an open source is you can make some modifications and you can create your own libraries. And what we can do is we can actually create a few jar files of those libraries and paste it up so that others can make use of it. Freelancers are benefiting in both ways, right? They can take up Android application development as a thing which they can sell out in the market, and also they can contribute to the entire ecosystem by creating a few set of reusable components that they can publish onto the GitHub or any other repository which they can feel like using from. I hope I have answered you here. Then there's also more interesting factor, all right? It's not that there has to be an application or what you should also understand here is that it is not merely that you create an application that is bought from the Play Store that makes money, right? So any application that is even coming free from the Google Play Store can also make money. And the way it does is it uses the AdMob, or say the advertisements is the one that is used in order to make money out of any Android application, right? So AdMob SDK is there that allows you to create the various advertisements, and similarly, the more the advertisements are shown on your application, the more money you make out of it, right? So that is why you must be wondering why there are so many free applications that are there on the Play Store. However, they are not charging us anything. What happens is they might not be charging you anything for the download, but once you install those applications, then you do have a way of making money out of it. So if you want to speak up, you have raised your hand. Do you want to speak up, Sunil? I hope this is clear to everyone. How exactly is the money being churned out from? Whenever we talk about an application, we create an application, we publish it on the Play Store for free, then also we are making some money out of it. Sunil, whenever the question gets answered, just do respond back on the chat window, right? Everyone, whenever anyone's questions gets answered, just respond back on the chat window. I hope this is clear to everyone. Any person having any questions, any doubts? Monetization. All right, I'm not getting much responses. Can I know how to build an Android app? That is correct, Sunil. That is something that we are going to tell you over the span of 10 sessions that we'll be having, right? I think you just joined in late. I told you how exactly this particular program works, right? So it is a 10-hour, or say a 10-session long thing that we have, wherein we'll be teaching you or working with you in conjunction in order to create an Android application, right? So all right, let's talk about what are the various building blocks of any Android application, first of all, and also what is the life cycle of an Android application, How does a mobile app handle events? Does an app running in the background can do a job like a network download or a music player? How do multiple apps access shared resources? These are some of the components, right, that you or people might not be aware about. What are the building blocks? What is the life cycle? All right, how do you handle the hardware key events? How do you do any background tasks with respect to a network download? How do you access, or say, how multiple applications access shared resources is something that we are going to talk about now one by one. Let's first of all talk about what are we more interested in. All right, so since Android, what exactly is Android is something that everyone should know. So if you talk about Android, it is an open software platform which comprises of an operating system, a middleware, and the applications that work on the middleware. If you talk about what is the language that is being used in order to create or develop our Android applications, it is Java, right? So if you talk about what this course is going to deal with is, it will allow you to create native Android applications, right? So that is how Android has evolved over a period of time. It started with cupcake, then it was donut, eclair, then it was froyo, gingerbread, honeycomb, ice cream sandwich, chili bean, Kit Kat, the latest one, lollipop, out in the market. God knows what's going to come next, right? So this is how it has evolved over a period of time. So when I talk about when I started working off on Android application development, it was donut version that I had started working on. And you see now it is around 5.0, which is a lollipop version that is out in the market. So a new release that is coming out on a frequent basis. It's just that, just to keep the users interested and also just to make sure that every single new addition is going to benefit, or say benefit the user community out there. Right? So that is how Android has evolved over a period of time. And there's also a relative percentage of how many devices are running on which, all right, which operating system. I have a question from Prabhat. Which is the best version to start working on? Start working on in terms of development, Prabhat? I tell you, it's not that we do not work on a single version. All right, Prabhat, let me tell you about how exactly a mobile application development gets done. We do not work on a single version, or we do not create an executable file for a single version, right? So there is a range that we try to target whenever we are creating an application. Omikrishna says Android Jelly Bean is the best one or not. At present, what happens is, Omikrishna, it is the ICS that we should be targeting as the minimum one. That is, I believe ICS is the most updated version that you have on any device. So any device that is working now will be having an ICS for sure. But you should always make sure that the target version that you're trying to build is this operating system distribution is global. That's correct. It is global. Then what happens is, OEMs, as you must have seen here, what happens is that the OEMs are the ones that actually customize the Android SDK as per their own needs whenever they are going to actually ship out an update. So for example, I say I have a Nexus 4 or a Nexus 5 or a Nexus 6. What happens on these devices is they receive the raw SDK update, right? Raw SDK update without any modifications. But if Samsung has to launch a operating system for, say, 5.0, what happens is they first take the raw 5.0 and they make changes to the raw 5.0 so that they actually customize the raw 5.0 to make use of new camera features, to make use of new location features, or any number of other features. They customize those features so that they can give you a new, different, or I would say a different UI look and feel for the camera app or something. So what happens is they roll out the OS distribution post some time. For example, I say 5.0 gets launched today, Samsung might be receiving or say sending out updates to all the devices in say another 2 months from now, whereas they take the raw SDK and they start building up on customizing of the raw SDK. Swami Krishna, right? So that is how it works, Jatin. All right. Neil says there is a lot of noise in audio. Is that correct? Is that the same for everyone? Is everyone facing a lot of noise here? Is the audio loud and clear to everyone? Let me just check. I believe I'm having no noise at all. Not sure where it is coming from. All right, everyone, just make sure that it is manageable for everyone. Can you give me a thumbs up if it is manageable for everyone? I'm just not able to figure out actually what could be the reason for this noise here. Avnish, do you want to speak up? Alright, there was a question that was asked to me about what is the Android operating system that is most used, right? So if you talk about it is the 4.0 that is most available on all the devices. If I want to develop an application, I'll make sure that 4.0 is the one that I'm definitely going to cover. Because most of the devices are actually working or running on Android SDK 4.0. I hope I have answered everyone here. Now let's talk about what all are the main building blocks of creating any Android application, right? It might be also what we need to understand here is that all the components might not be used in one application. However, there could be a possibility or a use case where I might be using all the components within a single application. I hope everyone understands what I'm trying to say here. Every single component that you have or talk about in an Android application is also a different component. There could be a possibility that a single application might not have all the components in it, and it could be also a possibility that a single application may have all the components within an application. I hope everyone understands what I'm trying to say here. Alright, Neil says, what is the difference between the beta updates and the normal updates? If you talk about the beta update, they have not stable releases, right? They have been just put up for testing purposes. So they are not stable, and then that is the reason why they are not rolled out, right? It's just for the testing purposes that they roll out the beta releases. Alright, let's talk about the components that we have in any Android application. First of all, you have an activity. In any Android application, the very first component that we talk about is an activity. That's correct. That's why only developers can use the beta release. That's very correct. If we talk about an activity, anything that you see on an Android screen is an activity. So every single screen that you see or come across with is an activity. So take an example here. You see a Facebook login screen, right? So the Facebook login screen that you see is an activity. What happens is that the Facebook login screen launches, or say, post you log in, gain your email, gain your password, you do a login. What happens is there opens up another screen. So the second screen that gets opened up here is another activity, right? So everything that you see on the screen is an activity. Take it like that. There's also one more component that if you take a look here, we talked about, which is intent, right? So the second component or the intent component is the one that drives this process. That is, an activity should be launching another activity is something that is governed with the help of the intents. Right, so there are a few screens. Screens are considered as activities, and the communication between the screens is something that is governed with the help of intents. Like alright, Neil has a question here. Like, while watching a video and a call occurs, then the display screen changes. Neil, that is something that is part of the life cycle, right? That is part of the activity life cycle, which we'll just cover in a few moments, right? Just keep this question on hold. We are going to cover this up in a few moments. So you see here, you see an activity life cycle. Can everyone see this here? A flowchart kind of a thing that is telling you what exactly is an activity life cycle. What I'm going to do is, I'll give you all some time to just read the various states of a life cycle and also go through this example or say this flowchart. Whenever you all are done, just write a D on the chat window. Everyone, just read it all by yourself so that when I'll be doing the explanation, it gets more clear to you all. Let's talk about every single step one by one, right? First of all, you see a starting state. So what does the starting state is? When an activity does not exist in the memory, it is in the starting state. So what happens is, whenever you launch a screen, right? So what happens is, it gets onto on create first, out of the screen, on start, and on resume, and finally when you see the screen, it is set to be running. That is the starting state and the running state. Create, start, resume, running. Now, what happens is, I open up a dialog box. Whenever you see, right, let me show you something. So this is my screen. And what happens whenever I open up any dialog box in front of the screen? What happens to my screen, everyone? What happens to my screen? Can you see this up? This portion is the one that is on my screen, right? And it is partially covered with the help of a dialog box. Right? Partially covered with the help of a dialog box. Everyone can see that? In this case, it is actually partially visible. The activity on the screen is partially visible, right? Everyone agrees with me here? Everyone agrees with me here? Is it partially visible? I see. When I say partially visible, what happens is that the activity goes into the pause state. Whenever it is partially visible, it is paused state. Now I do a back button press and I remove this dialog from the front of the activity. What happens in this case is, it goes into resume. Right, it goes into resume and becomes visible again. And when I say visible again, I say running. Anyone having any questions? That's correct, Neil. That's what I'm talking about. It's more so like shady kind of an effect. What is that, Sumi? What is that? I have interrupted the web session. What is that? Any person having any questions, any doubts, understanding, when does it enter into the pause state and when does it resume back into the on resume? Anyone having any questions? That's correct. Prabhat says the on resume is called the first time as well. That's correct, Prabhat. I'm talking about the lifecycle callbacks as and when they appear, all right? So it gets appeared in the very first launch, but if there is another dialog box that gets opened up in front of the screen and you just exit out of the dialog box, then it again gets called. Alright, so that is how the lifecycle callbacks works. Prabhat. Any person having any other doubts here? Any questions? Alright, a question for everyone now. When I'm looking at a screen and suddenly a call pops up, what happens? Is my screen completely not visible? Is it partially not visible? Question for everyone. I'm looking at a screen and there is suddenly a call that comes up on screen. Completely not visible, partially visible. Neil, just do a cross check, right? It is actually completely invisible. What happens is it goes into a completely invisible state. And let me tell you what all are the callbacks that go in this case. First of all, it enters into on call. Then it enters into on stop. Then it enters into on resume when you finish the call. Understand? It enters into on restart, sorry. It enters into on restart when you finish the call and calls on resume again. That's correct. Neil, I'm saying I took up the call. I did not actually reject the call. I took up the call. Even while it is ringing, all right? Even while it is ringing, it is always in the full screen mode. There's no background actively running, right? Even when if it is ringing. Everyone, understand the difference. When it is not visible, following life cycle callbacks get called on pause, on stop, on restart, on resume. Questions, doubts, anyone? Can it ever be made partially visible with coding? Prabhat, with the help of coding, what happens is we can raise our dialog box, right? The callbacks are something that is handled by the framework, but we can initiate the callbacks. Are you getting the point? We can always initiate the callbacks. It is just that the framework is the one that is handling the callbacks. Alright, Neil says, if a call occurs, the other activity gets paused. That's correct. Whenever a call occurs, the other activity gets paused, Neil. Prabhat, we do not have control over it, but we can play around with these values or say, depending on what exactly is the state of the activity at any point in time. We can actually use them to play around. That's correct. And whenever the call ends, it gets resumed. That's correct. Moving on, we talked about when it is in the pause state, when is it in the stop state. Now let's talk about this destroyed state. When I say I have the application up and running and I press the back button to exit out of the application, right? How many of you have seen that? Whenever you say launch an application, you just exit out of the application using a back button, right? So that is where the activity gets destroyed. So it is on pause, on stop, on destroy being called onto the activity. Any person having any questions, any doubts, understanding the activity life cycle, can let me know on the chat window. I'll wait for your confirmation. Any person having any questions, any doubts? All right, so thanks for the confirmation. That's correct. All right. Neil has a pretty good question here. But what about if we press the home button? Neil, you are going to answer it for me. I say when I press the home button, what happens? Is the activity visible to me? Neil, is the activity visible to me? Question for you. No, it's not. When you press the home button, what happens is activity is not visible to you, right? When you press the home button, it's not visible, right? So what should be the series of callbacks when an activity is not visible? On pause, on stop, right? On pause, on stop, and when you again make it visible, on restart, on resume. All right, Sri Vatsal has a very interesting question here. Very interesting question. He says, is there anything like the number of activities should be limited in an Android app as they consume much memory? Reason, Sri Vatsal, there is no such limitation under the number of activities that an application can have, because what happens is there is a GC that gets called up. So at any point in time, what happens is there will not be much memory allocated to the activities that the system can hold, right? So it automatically starts cleaning up the memory on time by time basis. So we need not be worried about it. Also, Srivatsav, let me also tell you something. Whenever the activity moves into the on-stop mode, it does not utilize any system resources. Right? It does not utilize any system resources when it moves into the on-stop mode. So Neil has a question, can Android app have limited memory? Not necessarily. The memory, if you talk about Sunil, is more so constrained on the basis of the device's internal storage. Right? Device's storage is the one that is a constraint here, not in terms of any application specific setting. Right? Getting the point? What is preferable? Is it preferable? Is it an activity or a fragment? Jatin, a very good question, indeed, I tell you. What happens is fragment, right? Fragment is also part of the activity. So you should not understand activity and fragment as two different components. It's more so like the fragment resides within the activity. Right? So if I say I have a scenario wherein I have a common header and a footer, right? So what I'll be doing is I say only the common header and footer needs to be the same. The rest of the component needs to be swapped or changed according to the user demands. I can use a fragment within an activity. The fragment is going to make use of the dynamic data that is going to change, and the activity will hold the static data in this case. Right? So it's like both are complementary. They are not entirely different things. They are complementary to each other. I hope this is clear. Questions, doubts, anyone? I'll wait for your response, Jatin, then we'll be moving ahead. That's correct. Alright, Jatin has now got me with a question. Can I have a single activity in my project and many fragments? That's correct. That is something that we can have, Jatin. Right? It could not be like only fragments and no activity. It cannot be like that. What happens is you have a frame layout inside the activity wherein you hold the fragment. If you do not have an activity, you cannot hold the fragment anywhere. Then the second component that we talked about is the intent. So we talked about intents. So I told you about it. What happens is it is more so a verb that needs to be done on something. You want to say switch an activity, you want to view something, you want to call someone, you want to play a music file. This is something that is entirely governed with the help of the intents. Right? So that is what is the purpose of the intents. It defines the action that needs to be carried out. Then moving on, you see, a switching between an activity is something that is governed with the help of an intent. Then we also have services. That's correct. Then we also have services. Services can be thought of as faceless components that keep running in the background. Right? And there are also types of services, unbound and bound. If I talk about bound service, they are the kind of service which runs till the lifespan of the activity which started the service, right? So if I say I have a screen and I started a service, irrespective of how many screens I'm actually having within the application, the service will keep running within those screens. However, if I talk about bound services will be actually working or running on only the screens that I have bound my service with. Right? Service you can think of as something that does not require a UI. Right? Since it does not require a UI, you can see that on the lifecycle, there is no on resume state here. Can you see that? It starts, it runs, it destroys. No resumption here. Just because it is not having any UI component. Since it's not having any UI component, it's not interacting with the user. Any person having any questions, any doubts here? I'll wait for your responses back on the chat window. We have talked about three components: activity, intents, services. Questions, doubts, anyone? Sunil says it's clear. I'll wait for others to also respond back. Examples for bound and unbound service. For example, Neil, I say I have a media player that I have bound to an activity. I have the UI controls for the media player, right? And they are actually available on only two screens. So then I'll be making use of the bound service in order to play the media file. However, I say I have an audio recording functionality that is available within my application. Irrespective of the screen that I'm in, the audio recording should go on and should stop wherever I stop it from any single screen. In that case, I'll be making use of an unbound service. Alright, so these are the use cases for both the bound and the unbound services. Ajay has a question, which base class to extend for the service? It is with the name service itself, Ajay. Right? The base class is the service itself. If you say Wally is a service, no Ajay, Wally is not a service. It is more so a utility for the thread handling, for the asynchronous calls handling. Wally is not a service, right? It is a library, not a service. Services example, the various tweets coming in from the threads or various notifications of the thread requests. Then another component which we have or which we talk about in Android application development is the content providers. So the content providers, if you talk about, are the ones that enables the sharing of data across applications. For example, when I say or talk about content providers, I talk about the device's data. So what happens is, if you talk about a device, data can contain messages, call logs, contacts, and a number of things. That is housed under this component, which we call as a database. So the content provider is a middleware between the database and my application, which will allow me to perform insert, update, delete, and query operations on these database and return me the results data. So it acts as a middleware for the system-wide resources that my application would like to use. Anyone having any questions here? Any queries? What is the object if the content provider to access the data? Ajay, can you repeat what are you asking here? What is the object if the content provider to access the data? It will return you depending on how you want to read the data, right? Ajay, let me tell you, whenever you read the data from a database, you always read it with the help of a cursor. So you can actually provide what element you are reading up from the cursor. Is it a string? Is it an integer? Is it a blob object? Right? So that is how you can actually filter it out and store it within your application. Data type is something that should be governed with the help of a cursor rather than with the help of a database. Ajay. I hope that is what you were asking about. All right, very good question. Here, Ajay says, what is a content resolver? All right, let me give you an example, Ajay. There's one more interesting question asked by Ajay here. It says, what is a content resolver? This is my centralized database, Ajay. And what I'm having is, I'm having a layer of content provider in my. But I'm having around four applications that want to have access to all the contacts that I have within my application. Right? So what they'll do, they'll ask the content provider to give them all the contacts. So content provider will query the database and return me the contacts back to my application. But how does my content provider know which application is requesting for what sort of data? Is there any linking how my content provider can know which data needs to be sent back to which application? Can you see or identify any linkage here? Everyone, can anyone identify any linkage? There's no linkage, right? That particular linkage is being provided with the help of a content resolver object. The content resolver object is the one that resolves the content to be provided to what application. Ajay. I hope I have answered you now. What exactly is a content resolver? You know the reason now. Let's close this up. Then another component, very interesting one, is the broadcast receiver. When you talk about, for example, what I'm doing is, I'm saying I'm having an alarm, right? I usually get up at say around 6:30 or any time, and what I do is every night I set up an alarm to wake up at some point in time. So whenever the time comes due, I get the alarm message ringing. That is what exactly is a broadcast receiver. It works on a subscriber publisher pattern wherein first of all, you register for something to be subscribed, and wherever the system event is supposed to happen, you get the notification that this is happening, now you need to do something, right? So it's more so like an alarm is just an example of how we can make use of or think of broadcast receivers as a component. Any person having any questions, any doubts understanding this? Broadcast receivers, any questions, any doubts? All right, Prabhat says, sorry for the late question, but can fragments have intents as well? If you talk about Prabhat, fragments actually are a UI thing, and intents are more so action thing, right? So if you want to launch something from the fragment, you can make use of the intents, right? So they can be used with in conjunction with each other. Right? Another example could be, for example, Neil, what I'm doing is I'm traveling from one place to another and there is a change in the time zone. Whenever there is a change in the time zone, what happens is you get a notification here that your time zone has changed. Do you want to update your time zone now or not? Is another example of a broadcast receiver. Ajay says, so the broadcast receiver uses pending intent. That depends on the usage, Ajay, right? I'll tell you about it in the later sessions. That depends on how you are actually using it. Some might not require pending intents. Some might need the pending intents. That's correct. The context can start the activity and it can start the service. That's correct, Ajay. Example of a broadcast receiver that we just talked about. So we have talked about the various building blocks of any Android application where we say an activity is a screen. The intent is the one that governs what action needs to be done. Services are the ones that take care of the background tasks or background jobs. Content providers provide access to the central repository of the database. Broadcast receivers more so work as a host or say a notifier for any system event that we are trying to use. Any questions? Any doubts from anyone? I'll wait for your responses. Any questions, any doubts? I hope all is clear till this point in time. And now I believe everyone answers these questions for me. Everyone will be able to answer these questions for me. Avnish has a question. Go on, Avnish. Anyone who thinks he cannot answer any of these questions, just respond back with a Y under the chat screens. Anyone who feels that they do not know the answers to any of these questions. Right, Facebook gets notifications at an eye, but still it is neither visible or in memory. Notifications is altogether a different concept of niche, right? Notification is a different concept. That's correct. It's more so of a design thing, right? Ajay says, what is this context? Do you want to know the difference between this and the context, Ajay? Context is a parent class and activity is the one that is driven from the parent class. Since it is driven from the parent class, we can use interchangeably this and the context, right? But context is the parent class. It is the services. And for the last one, it is the content providers. Prabhat, for the last answer, it is the content providers. Right? Everyone understands this now? So the job trend that is going on in terms of the mobility, you can see that the graph has been peaking up. Can multiple services be running in the background? That's correct, Mohammed. We can have multiple services running in the background. That is a possibility. So increasing demand for mobile experts nowadays. Let's also talk about what we have done in the past. Few of the applications have also been successful for all of the students who have created them. Can you see that one of the most popular applications that we have is from a student, Mehvish, right? She built up an application for all the local services that are there in Kashmir, right? So one of the applications that is already there and she has been very, she was a student which was very, who was actually very confident, very understood, understanding of the various concepts, and you can see that she has actually come up with something very interesting. You can actually, Ajay says, how can we differentiate multiple services? You can differentiate the multiple services on the basis of the service name. Ajay, that is how you can differentiate. A few other applications developed by Adirika Learners, PNR Inquiry app, a blackjack gaming application, or a box shopping portal application. So these are the course topics that we have for all the 10 sessions, module 1 to module 10. How it works, you already know. Any questions apart from the ones that we have talked about, you can always respond back on the chat window. Alright then guys, this is all that I had for all of you in today's session. I hope to see you all in this session that we have, this coming Saturday, we are starting up a new batch, right?